Section 1.2, Memory and Storage. Part 1.2.1, Primary Storage, Memory. Primary storage is the storage that directly connects to the CPU. Primary storage is needed because the CPU cannot directly interact with secondary storage. Primary storage is usually faster than secondary storage. Here are some examples of primary and secondary storage. Primary, RAM, ROM, cache, registers. Say that again. Primary, RAM, ROM, cache, registers. Secondary storage, optical, for example, DVDs and CDs. Magnetic, for example, hard drives and floppy disks. Solid state, for example, SD cards, solid state drives, etc. RAM versus ROM. Hear me now. RAM is volatile. ROM is non-volatile. RAM is volatile. ROM is non-volatile. What does volatile mean? Volatile means it loses data when power is lost. Volatile means it loses data when power is lost. The way I think of this is when I think of the word volatile, I think about a three-year-old having an absolutely monolithic temper tantrum. Wah! They're being volatile. They lose it. If we're being volatile, we lose the data when the power is lost. RAM is volatile. ROM doesn't lose data when the power is lost. ROM is non-volatile. It doesn't lose its data like a non-volatile child doesn't lose their temper. Here's some more details about RAM. RAM stands for Random Access Memory. Random Access Memory. RAM stores currently running programs. RAM is volatile, obviously. RAM is faster than secondary storage. RAM is faster than secondary storage. But it's slower than cache. Let's look at ROM. ROM stands for read-only memory. Read-only memory. ROM stores the BIOS. ROM stores the BIOS. RAM stores currently running programs. ROM stores the BIOS. Just so you know, the BIOS is like that black and white screen that comes on before Windows appears. It's what you need to load into an operating system, but don't worry about it. You don't need to know that, but that's what a BIOS is. ROM is non-volatile. It doesn't lose data when power is lost. ROM stores data that should not be changed. That's why it's called read-only memory. It's not easy to write to. ROM stores data that shouldn't be deleted when the computer turns off. If your BIOS was deleted when the computer turned off, you would only be able to use it once and then it would break. That'd be miserable. Virtual memory. Virtual memory is used when RAM is full. When RAM is full. Virtual memory uses part of the secondary storage to use as temporary RAM. I'll say that again. Virtual memory uses part of the secondary storage as temporary RAM. Data is moved from the RAM to the secondary storage to make space in the RAM. RAM can then be filled with new data, improving performance. When data in virtual memory is needed again, it's put back into the RAM, because what is RAM? It's primary memory. What can the CPU interact with? Primary memory. Can't interact with the secondary storage. What are the advantages of virtual memory? It improves performance, but not as much as adding real RAM, because it's slower than real RAM. Disadvantage, again, slower than real RAM. And here's one. Excessive use of virtual memory can cause disk thrashing. Section 1.2.2, secondary storage. The need for secondary storage. Secondary storage, SS, is non-volatile and is needed if we want to store data permanently, for storing data permanently, even when the device is off. Secondary storage stores data. For example, images, videos, etc. Secondary storage can also be used to transfer files between devices. The types of secondary storage. There are three. Optical. For example, CD, DVD, Blu-ray. Benefits. They're cheap.
Very cheap.
That's why companies distribute movies and games on them. Because it doesn't cost them lots of money. They're very portable. You can fit a DVD in your pocket if you want to. They're robust. I can throw my DVD at myself and it won't break, as long as I don't scratch it. The disadvantage is that it's slow. It's very slow. That's why a lot of your Xbox games tell you to install the game to the hard drive, because if you ran it off the disc, it would be too slow to use. The second technology is magnetic. For example, hard drive, magnetic tape, and floppy disk. The positives, the advantages, are that these have a large capacity. Hard drives are chunky boys, they are massive, and they're relatively cheap per gigabyte. Two disadvantages though, they've got moving parts, so they're not very durable. If you drop a hard drive when it's spinning, that needle is gonna rip your data to shreds. They're also heavy and not very portable. I cannot fit a hard drive in my pocket. The third and final secondary storage technology is solid state. Examples include USB flash drives, SD cards, and solid state drives. Benefits: very fast. Very fast. Fast! That's why we sometimes call them flash drives, because they're flash like a flash of lightning. Another benefit, there's no moving parts, so they're very durable. I can drop an SSD from a first story building and it'll probably still work. Another benefit, lightweight and portable. So we got three benefits. Where's the catch? Is the catch. They are mega money. They are super expensive. Very expensive. the properties of secondary storage, or sometimes called the characteristics, properties slash characteristics of secondary storage. These are the properties that you look for when you're going to buy a piece of secondary storage. There are six of them. Capacity. How big does it get? Speed. How fast does it go? Cost. How much will it make you cry when you hand over your wallet? Portability. Does it fit in your pocket? Durability. How many times can your four-year-old brother punch it before it breaks? And finally, reliability. Will it die on its own, or will it survive a very long time? Section 1.2.3, Units. The smallest unit we have is the bit. The bit is either a 1 or a 0. It's just one column on your binary table. For example, the binary number 1001 would have 4 bits, because there's 4 ones and zeros. Computers can't understand deanery, but they do understand binary. That's important to note. Now, this is a big one. These are the units of data storage in order of size. Let's go from the smallest to the biggest. First, a bit. We've explained that. 0 or 1. Next, nibble, which is 4 bits. Next, a byte, which is 8 bits, or 2 nibbles. Next is a kilobyte, which is 1,000 bytes. Next is a megabyte, which is 1,000 kilobytes. Next is a gigabyte, which is 1,000 megabytes. You're seeing a pattern here. Next is a terabyte, which is 1,000 gigabytes. And finally, a petabyte, which is 1,000 gigabytes. Section 1.2.4, Data Storage. Binary to deanery conversion is extremely easy. All you do is make your binary table, starting with 1 on the right and doubling every time it goes to the left. So 1, 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128. You then fill in numbers above, below the appropriate binary table until you get the number that you want. So let's do an example. If I've got a 4-bit binary number that goes 1248 from right to left, and the number I have underneath is 1001, that's going to be a 9, because 8 add 1 is 9. Just do it in reverse for binary to deanery. Binary addition. Basically, there's two ways that you can do binary addition. I recommend using both. Way one is to convert the two numbers from binary to deanery. You've just learned how to do that. Add them up and then convert them back to binary. Straightforward. So for example, 1100, add 1001 would become 12 add 9, which we know is 21, which in binary is 10101, because 16 add 4 add 1 is 21. The second method is the remainder method. Explaining that on audio would be almost impossible, but the idea is that you use the remainder method to add up the two binary numbers. Take a look at the workbook and have a look at that if you want to. You can do it either the first way or this way. it doesn't really matter. I recommend doing both, though, so you can check your answer. Deanery to hexadecimal conversion. Hexadecimal is base 16, binary is base 2, and deanery is base 10. The only weird thing with hex is the numbers 10 to 15 are represented with letters. So 10 is A, 11 is B, C is 12, D is 13, E is 14, and F is 15. Why did I have to think so hard? Let's do a hex conversion example. Nice, easy one. So just like with binary, you draw out your table first, starting with 1 on the right and then going up in powers of 16. So 1, then 16 to the right of it. That's all you need. If I add the hex number 2A, that would be 2 lots of 16 and A lots of 1. What's A? 10. So that'd be 2 lots of 16, 32. Add 10 would be 42. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. This is a weird one. Binary to hex conversion. This one's actually really... really easy. Let's do AB. So the hex number AB. A in the 16s, B in the 1s. We just convert each half of that to nibbles. So what's A in a binary nibble? If A is 10, in binary that would be 1010, and B would be 1011. We put them together, and boom, we've got it. So AB in binary is 1010101. Done. Easy peasy, lemon squeezy. Finally, binary shifts. Binary shift is where we move the binary number either left or right. If we move it left to the place of 1, it doubles. If we move it right to the place of 1, it halves. Bish, bash, bosh, done. Characters. Let's look at characters. A character set is all the characters that a computer can use. In a character set, each character is represented by a unique binary number. There's two character sets that you need to know for your GCSE, ASCII and Unicode. Oh, and extended ASCII, but it's not really a character set, it's just ASCII with an extra bit. ASCII, American Standard Code for Information Interchange. Here's some things you need to know about ASCII. It can only represent English characters. That's the disadvantage. It uses 7 bits, 255 characters in total. The advantage is it's smaller than Unicode, but again, the disadvantage is it can only represent English. Side note, extended ASCII uses 8 bits. That includes things like European symbols, you know, German umlauts and whatnot. Unicode, not unicorn. Unicode doesn't use 7 bits. No, it doesn't use 8 bits. No, it uses 32 bits. It's a big boy. 32 bits. It can represent all the characters in all languages. Japanese, Chinese, Arabic, etc. can all be represented with Unicode. They can even represent emojis too. Much bigger than ASCII. It's the disadvantage. File size is much bigger. Let's look at images. First, pixels. Images are made of pixels. These images we call bitmaps. Images that are made of pixels are called bitmaps. Each pixel has a binary number that represents its color, and each color has a unique binary code. Unique. Each color has a unique, that's a keyword, binary code. Unique. Let's look at metadata. The definition of metadata is data about the image file. That's it. Data about the image file. Here's OCR's approved list of metadata. Listen and listen carefully. Height, width, color depth, resolution, geolocation. That's the location that it was taken in. Date, time, last modified, and file type. One more time. Height, width, color depth, resolution, geolocation, date or time last modified, and file type. Easy peasy lemon. What's color depth? Color depth, the definition is how many bits represent each pixel. How many bits represent each pixel? The higher the color depth, the better the quality. The higher the color depth, the better the quality. The higher the color depth, the more storage space that we're going to be using, because the file size is bigger. Resolution. Definition: the number of pixels in an image. The higher the resolution, the better the quality. That's the benefit. Disadvantage: the higher the resolution, the more storage space that we use, because the file size is going to be bigger, because there's more pixels. Sound. We're going to look at sampling. Sampling. Analog, i.e. data sound in the real world, must be sampled and stored in binary. Amplitude of that waveform is sampled / measured. The amplitude is converted to binary. Samples are taken, get this, at regular intervals. For example, 44,000 times a second. One more time. Analog sound is sampled and stored in binary. The amplitude of the waveform is sampled and measured. The amplitude is converted to binary, and samples are taken, get this, regular intervals. Sample rate and frequency. Sample rate / frequency. The number of samples taken per second. Sample rate / frequency means the number of samples, because it's the frequency is the number of times we do something. The sample frequency is the number of samples taken per second. The higher this is, the better the quality. But the higher this is, the more storage space it's going to take. Duration. If I have to tell you what this means, I can't help you. Duration is how long the sound file is. One song might be 1 minute, another might be 20 hours. This one feels like it. The longer the duration, the more storage space the sound will take. Pretty obvious, to be honest. Bit depth. This is the last part for this section. Bit depth. The number of bits per sample taken. The number of bits per sample taken. Just like with images and color depth. The higher the bit depth, the better the quality. The higher the bit depth, the better the quality. The higher the bit depth, the more storage space. Are you seeing a pattern yet? The more storage space it'll take, and the file size will be bigger. Section 1.2.5, compression. The need for compression. Compression reduces file size. It makes uploads and downloads faster. And it takes up less space on the secondary storage or servers. Two types of compression: lossy and lossless. Let's look at lossy first. Lossy, data is permanently lost. It reduces the file size, but it also reduces the quality. It uses an algorithm to remove repeated / unnecessary data. Lossy compression works differently across different file types, you know, text, images, and sound. So, for example, text, you can't do lossy compression with it. If you lose a letter, you lose the meaning of the whole flipping thing.
Don't use lossy compression on me. I am text. You will kill me, LOL.
Images, we can reduce the color depth and we can reduce the resolution for lossy compression, making the quality worse. For sound, we can reduce the sample rate and the bit depth. Pretty obvious. Reduces the quality, but saves storage space. Lossy. Data is temporarily lost, but comes back when the file is decompressed. For example, a zip. This is great for text and for code when data cannot be permanently lost. That was such a big section, I'm gonna cry. Get ready for section 1.3, BRB.